We have former White House Communications Director under President Obama, Anita Dunn, and former advisor to President George W. Bush and John McCain, Mark McKinnon. Mark is the executive producer and co-host of Showtime's The Circus, which returns for its third season on April 15th, and he is decked out in a very fine-looking hat. Good morning to both of you. Mark, I want to start with you, and I just want to start with what Raj Shah just said there on tape. He's basically saying, look, this is all part of an ongoing background check investigation, so we can't give you the information. Is that right? And does the public deserve answers on when these officials in the White House knew about the abuse allegations?
Oh, no, it just makes it worse. I mean, when you say you have information that you can't give out, that raises everybody's antenna. There's three basic rules that we have in the White House for communicating a situation like this. Number one, don't make a bad story worse. And here we are a week after this story broke, still talking about it. Number two, speed kills a bad story. Kill it in the crib. Don't let it walk. Don't let it crawl. Don't let it run circles around you like it is now. And number three, if you change the story, you prolong the story. So we have a situation now where every day, almost every news cycle, we get a new iteration, a new version of what happened. And all that's doing is prolonging and making it look worse. And by the way, this is a comms problem that is in many ways sort of obscuring the bigger problem, which is that we had somebody who didn't have security clearance who had one of the most sensitive positions in the White House.
Yes.
Who never should have had it.
And I do want to get into that momentarily. But first, with the comms problem, Anita Dunn, you're the perfect person to talk to. You had Hope Hicks's job in the Obama White House. Would there ever have been a scenario where you would be the person crafting the statement about the person on whom the scandal revolves around if you were having a romantic relationship with that person? Why was Hope Hicks the person crafting the statement about Rob Porter?
So there are so many questions to unpack right there, Allison. But let's be clear. The White House communications director doesn't get brought into clearance questions or security issues until there's a problem. And in this case, given the fact that she had this relationship with Rob, it probably would have made a lot more sense for her to take herself out of that circle, at least initially. But there are bigger problems here, and Mark has outlined some of them. But I think that what's really critical here is to say, how does the White House now fix this? And one former White House communications director's advice would be, use your sheriff's event today to go make the strongest declaration you can about supporting the two very strong women who walked out of those relationships with Rob Porter and victims of domestic abuse nationwide. Go fix it today, Mr. President. As Mark says, time is ticking.
Anita, that is some great free advice that you are giving. Very generous that you are giving to the Trump White House. And if he does that, if the president does that, does this clean it up? I mean, then can everybody sort of exhale and say, okay, he's finally addressing the victims of domestic violence?
There's an accountability question that Mark outlined that is going to be very real. Chris's lead into this piece, the facts, the timeline, there are all kinds of questions. But listen, this is a White House that has never had good process. Bad process leads to bad outcomes. In this case, a very, very bad outcome. And they're doing what they like to do, first blame the media and then blame the FBI. It's not the FBI's job to make decisions on security clearance. It's the counsel to the chief of staff to the president. So the bad process they have in this White House has led to a disastrous outcome. They can short-term fix this problem, but the bigger problem here is actually the fact that they thought it was okay to have this person in an extremely sensitive job that sees every document that goes to the president, yeah. The gatekeeper.
So, Mark, that leads to your issue, which is how can this guy have been functioning without full security clearance? I mean, is that commonplace that after a year, somebody with this much access to the president wouldn't have security clearance? And what is the danger?
No, it's not commonplace at all. I can tell you for sure that nobody with any sort of sensitive position in the Bush White House would have served in that position without full FBI security clearance. And this goes to a deeper problem, I think, which is that there's just a general staffing problem with this administration. In other words, they're having trouble getting good people and getting good people to stay. And therefore, I think they get into situations where they have people like Porter in the position that he was because they thought that he did a good job, and they thought, oh boy, here's a guy who handles the paper well, and let's just kind of obscure some issues in his past that may be problematic. But this White House now has 34% turnover in the first year of its administration, which is three times the worst administration before that, which was Ronald Reagan.
That bears repeating, 34% of turnover for high-ranking aides and officials. So that tells you something. And Anita, just to be clear about what you were saying about they're pinning it on the FBI, right? So you heard Raj Shah there, you've heard Sarah Sanders. Well, the FBI was in charge of the security clearance. That seems to be what they're saying to try to get out of why Don McGahn didn't act on this if he knew about it for a year, why John Kelly didn't act sooner. So just help us understand, because you were in the White House in this role, does the White House grant security clearance or does the FBI?
The FBI doesn't grant the security clearance. At the end of the day, the decision is with the White House. And the reality is that from January 2017, when Rob Porter first reportedly told Don McGahn about these issues, there's no way this White House should have had this person in that position. There just isn't. And as the FBI background process confirmed the very serious nature of what he had done, There's no way he should have been in this position.
So Anita, what does it say that they did have him in this position? What does that tell you about how seriously they took these allegations?
Who can know what was going through their minds? But what we can infer from the fact that they kept him in this position is that clearly domestic abuse is not an issue that they take seriously when it's compared to having someone who they think is moving paper well. And that's a value judgment that I think women across this country are going to remember as they head for the polls this fall.
Mark, what's the upshot here for you that they kept him in this position knowing about these allegations?
Well, I think it's a process problem and a staffing problem. They're having high turnover, high rates, so they found somebody, as Anita said, who could shuffle the paper, and they said, well, let's just look at that and let's not look at the deeper issues about who is qualified to be working in this White House and who should have clearance. And that has been a problem at the very beginning. I mean, the White House, more than any operation in the country, obviously, needs to have a really buttoned-up process. Process is important in a White House, as Anita can testify. And if you screw up the process, it leads to bigger problems like this.
And so, I mean, I understand that you're saying that it's process. And so many people, though, Anita, see it as deeper than that. That there is generally, when the president has to come out on a side, he, as we've seen in the past and in this, takes the side of the accused, not the side of the women who are making the allegations.
This is a president who had the press brought into his event last Friday so he could talk about how victimized Rob Porter was. This is a president who has been tweeting on all kinds of issues since the end of last week, including his thoughts on due process and the Me Too movement and raising issues around that. This is a president who, as recently as this morning, has tweeted about infrastructure and DACA. So we know he hasn't lost his phone. We know he still has his ability to communicate, but he hasn't said one word supporting directly the women who suffered domestic abuse. And that tells you all you need to know about this White House and this president.
Mark, the first wife of Rob Porter has felt compelled to go public and write an op-ed in the Washington Post. I think that we need to just talk about how striking that is for victims of domestic violence. Even if you want to call them alleged victims of domestic violence, because of the stigma attached to that. But she was so disheartened by what the women in the White House had said. Kellyanne Conway saying that she doesn't worry about Hope Hicks because Hope Hicks is a strong woman. Here is what Colby Holderness, the first wife, part of what she's saying in this op-ed. Monday, White House Press Secretary Sarah Huckabee Sanders again declined to say whether the president believes Jennifer Willoughby, the second wife, and me. While I cannot say I am surprised, I expected a woman to do better. Behind the scenes, Mark, in the White House, what should the president's advisors like Sarah Sanders and Kellyanne be saying to him?
Well, the first piece of advice they should have said is the very first statement out of this White House should be support and sympathy for the victims. That should have been the very first thing. And the fact that we have the victims still talking about how this White House has failed to come to their support in any fashion, any kind of statement of support, still 7 days later, just testifies to a much greater problem in the White House, which is a tendency and a reflex to defend the perpetrators and not the victims.
Okay, Anita Dunn, Mark McKinnon, thank you very much for sharing your expertise from inside the White House with us.